The class is answering the new atheism, and I'm in the process of responding to the new atheist's assertion that there are no rational reasons to believe the claims of Christianity are true. And I've argued that the existence of the universe, the existence of an objective moral standard, the existence of free will, and the origin of life are reasons to believe in the existence of God. And I'm in the middle of arguing that it's more reasonable to believe that purposeless, directionless, blind, natural processes are not sufficient to explain the diversity of life on Earth. It is more reasonable to believe that those natural, blind, purposeless processes are not sufficient to explain the diversity of life on Earth than to believe they are. And that implies the existence of God by requiring an intelligence behind life's diversity. So just as when I looked at the origin of life, I'm now talking about the diversity of life and suggesting to you that blind, purposeless processes are not sufficient to explain the diversity of life. As I said last week, this is a subject that is too broad and too complex to be dealt with as just one little piece of a larger study. So what I'm doing here is I just noted that the vast majority of scientists, they do embrace the naturalistic scenario. The scientific establishment accepts the naturalistic story. I told you that, but then I gave you a few quotes, some broadsides from some well-known scientists to help keep you from being intimidated by the fact the scientific establishment swallows the naturalistic story. And I ended by directing you to a list of over 900 scientists who are skeptical of the ability of random mutation and natural selection to account for the complexity of life. So I gave you that web page, and then I also cited you to my categorized list of online articles of interest to creationists. I've done this for years. I now have over 1,300 categorized articles. You can go read to your heart's content. I mean, there are many, many articles there, some of them quite in-depth. And now, I want you to compare the skepticism you see in the 900-plus scientists who signed that statement that I just had up there, and in those you see who have written many, many PhDs in the list that I have, the categorized list of online articles of interest to creationists. Now, you compare that to Dawkins, Richard Dawkins' statement in 1989 book review in the New York Times. Here's what Dawkins said. It is absolutely safe to say that if you meet somebody who claims not to believe in evolution, that person is ignorant, stupid, or insane, or wicked, but I'd rather not consider that. Now, it's not that people like Dawkins don't see the evidence of design in living organisms. They see the evidence of design. They just insist that it's an appearance of design, that it's really an illusion. Yes, I see the evidence there. It looks designed, but it's not really designed. The impression of design is a fake out. It's an illusion. Or you think it's design, but that's not really the case. You can see this. Here's what Dawkins says in 1986 in his book, The Blind Watchmaker. Biology is the study of complicated things that give the appearance of having been designed for a purpose. The emphasis is on appearance because he means they give the appearance, but they're not really designed. Similarly, the atheist and Nobel Prize winning biochemist Francis Crick, he wrote in 1990, biologists must constantly keep in mind, you got to keep reminding yourself of this, constantly keep in mind that what they see was not designed, but rather evolved. Dawkins said in his 2004 book, A Devil's Chaplain, he says, the feature of living matter that most demands explanation is that it is almost unimaginably complicated in directions that convey a powerful illusion of deliberate design. The atheist Michael Shermer, in his 2006 book, Why Darwin Matters, he says the design inference comes naturally. The reason people think a designer created the world is because it looks designed. Jerry Coyne said in 2009, you know, one of the new atheists, Jerry Coyne, he said in his 2009 book, Why Evolution is True, if anything is true about nature, it is that plants and animals seem intricately and almost perfectly designed for living their lives. So you see, they say, look, you have to keep reminding yourself that what you see only looks designed. It's not really designed. Keep telling yourself, no, that's just, it looks nice, an illusion. It looks nice. Why do they have to keep telling themselves that? Why do they have to keep reminding themselves that what clearly seems designed really isn't designed? It's really the product of purposeless, blind, directionless, unintelligent forces. Why do they have to keep reminding themselves of that? And it is because they are committed to a materialist philosophy. They have a higher commitment to a materialist philosophy that is a non-negotiable for them, that matter is all there is. There is no spiritual reality. There is no supernatural. So what are you left with? You are left with matter and law acting on matter and energy over time. That's it. That is a philosophical commitment that they have. Let me read to you what the Harvard biologist Richard Lewontin wrote in a book review in the New York Review of Books in January of 1997. Harvard biologist Richard Lewontin: our willingness to accept scientific claims that are against common sense is the key to an understanding of the real struggle between science and the supernatural. We take the side of science in spite of the patent absurdity of some of its constructs, in spite of its failure to fulfill many of its extravagant promises of health and life, in spite of the tolerance of the scientific community for unsubstantiated just-so stories, because we have a prior commitment, a commitment to materialism, the meaning that matter is all there is. Matter, law acting on matter, everything just shakes out from that. He continues, it is not that the methods and institutions of science somehow compel us to accept a material explanation of the phenomenal world, but on the contrary, that we are forced by our a priori in advance, our a priori adherence to material causes to create an apparatus of investigation and a set of concepts that produce material explanations, no matter how counterintuitive, no matter how mystifying to the uninitiated. Moreover, that materialism is absolute, for we cannot allow a divine foot in the door. I just want you to see what is at work. You see, if the rules of the game, if I say that all that we can consider, by definition, science must be restricted to purely naturalistic causes, well, then that's all I'm going to consider and look at. And so that's what's going on. Why do they have to keep reminding themselves? It is because we have a prior commitment to a materialist philosophy that demands that only material causes can be invoked. So that's why. You say, why? Yes, it looks designed, but design is not an option because design is intelligent, and we know that there is no such intelligence, so let's just keep working to find this. That's what's going on. The National Academy of Sciences, which is quite a high-ranking institution in our culture, it declared in its 1998 publication, Teaching About Evolution and the Nature of Science, the statements of science must invoke only natural things and processes. The theory of evolution is one of these explanations. And the notion, what I'm saying to you, is that there's this a priori commitment, philosophical commitment to materialism. This isn't something produced through some scientific inquiry. This is a philosophical commitment to materialism, and it is that what drives the necessity to find naturalistic explanations, because that's the higher commitment. Well, this was shown quite starkly in a letter that was published. It was in the journal Nature, a very well-respected science journal. In September of 1999, a scientist named Scott Todd, he put it this way. Even if all the data point to an intelligent designer, such an hypothesis is excluded from science because it is not naturalistic. Now, I can't say it any plainer than that. That's the idea, okay? All we can consider are naturalistic explanations. Now, related to this is the new atheist's attempt to demonize Christians by charging them with being anti-science, which is a mortal sin in our culture. You want to show somebody to be a slopehead, you call them, well, they're anti-science. Oh, boy, yeah, they're back there. They're just, you know, that's how you get at them. So that's one of the things that is said. You see, you're anti-science. Well, if you define science this way, you see, so they're saying that we're going to call you anti-science, and they're going to come after you like that. Now, Christians are happy to investigate the natural world as vigorously as anyone. In fact, the great scientists from history were believers. I probably should have gone and pulled up some of the names. And people could have said, whoa, like Newton and all this, like many, many people. You know, so they're all, Christians are perfectly happy to explore nature as vigorously as anyone, and they do not deny any facts discovered in the investigation. It is not like, here is a fact sitting, oh, I can't. Not at all. Don't deny any facts that are discovered. Where they part company with the atheist is that Christians limit the inferences they draw from the data to things that are compatible with what God has revealed in Scripture. In other words, Christians, shockingly enough, believe the Bible is the Word of God. Oh, how terrible. Christians believe the Bible is the Word of God, and therefore it is true. I know in our society, no, you can't believe that. But we do, as have Christians throughout the millennia, as have Jews. We believe the Bible is the Word of God, and therefore what it says is true. So rather than draw a conclusion from the circumstantial evidence that contradicts what God has revealed in Scripture, we look for interpretations of the evidence, the data of nature, that are consistent with what God has revealed in Scripture. Now, this brings howls of derision from atheist scientists who insist that it's inherently unscientific, a debauching of the scientific enterprise, as Richard Dawkins puts it, to allow the supposed divine revelation of a holy book to limit the inferences one is willing to draw from the facts found in nature. They say that's just a travesty. You know, you just don't know anything if you're going to do that. Let me give you an example. Here's how I've tried to illustrate the different approaches and see if this resonates with you. Imagine a John Doe corpse. You know, a John Doe, unidentified corpse. A John Doe corpse is brought into a morgue in which two medical examiners work. An angel appears to one of the medical examiners. And the angel tells this medical examiner, this John Doe is 12 years old, and then vanishes. So this is what happens. The two medical examiners begin their examination of the body. They're going to go and give it the look over and investigate. And they see that this person is entirely bald, almost. He's got some gray hair, maybe even white. Around the sides, he's got wrinkled, baggy, spotted skin. I could demonstrate. He's got something like that. And they do some tests, and they find that this John Doe has hardening of the arteries. So the one medical examiner, he infers from those facts that the deceased is approximately 80 years old. But the examiner who was told by the angel that the deceased was 12 years old, he's unwilling to sign off on that inference. That is an inference from data and circumstances. He says, okay, that says 80, but this guy's not willing to sign off on that inference. He tells the other examiner, you're mistaken about the age. An angel told me that this John Doe is only 12 years old. The other examiner laughs at him. And he says that we must base our conclusions on science, not on superstition. The facts prove this John Doe is around 80 years old, and you are rejecting science by rejecting that conclusion. Well, the first examiner, he says, look, there could be another explanation for the facts. For the facts we discovered in our examination, one that is consistent with the fact an angel told me the deceased is only 12. And because I trust the angel, I want to keep searching for an explanation that answers how could the John Doe be 12 years old and be almost completely bald, have white or gray hair, have wrinkled, baggy, and spotted skin, and have hardening of the arteries. Just because you don't believe angels exist is no reason for me to conduct my investigation according to your prejudices. And with that, the other examiner tells him, away from me, you non-scientist. Okay? Now, further examination by the first examiner, it reveals certain anomalies. Perhaps the John Doe's eyes are too clear. Or perhaps that there is the amount of wear on the teeth or the joints are inconsistent with such an advanced age. And because he was unwilling to accept the inference that ignored the angel's revelation, the first examiner discovers that this John Doe suffered from a medical disorder, something like progeria, that produces these symptoms in a child. Was that science? You see, didn't reject any facts, fully explored, but had its own higher commitments. You see, had its own higher commitments. Now notice that the atheists, likewise, they have limits on the kind of inferences they're willing to draw from the facts of nature. They limit the conclusions they're willing to draw to those that do not contradict their philosophical commitment to materialism. Their philosophical commitment that there is no God or anything supernatural. So you can have the inference of a designer and the inference of God staring them in the face, and they reject that. Why? Because they have a higher commitment. Okay, you have your higher commitment, I have mine. But yet you get to call what you do science, and you call what I do superstition. Okay, I want you to see the concepts, what's going on. Because that is something that gets thrown at Christians a lot. Okay, recap on God's existence. The existence of the universe implies God's existence. Objective morality requires God's existence. Free will requires God's existence. The origin of life requires intelligent design, which implies God's existence. Diversity of life cannot be explained solely by natural processes, which implies God's existence. And next, and very fittingly here on Easter, I want to suggest to you that it is more reasonable to believe that Christ was raised from the dead than to believe he was not. And the resurrection of Christ supports the existence of the God of Scripture. Now, no known natural process can restore life to a person who's been dead for days. So if Jesus was raised from the dead, he necessarily was the object of a supernatural power. Now, given that Jesus claimed a unique relationship with the God revealed in the Old Testament, that God is the most likely supernatural power to have raised him, and that is a claim that is made repeatedly by the writers of the New Testament. So, Jesus being raised from the dead is central. It is pivotal to the Christian faith. Now, whether he was in fact raised from the dead, this can be investigated historically. Okay, what do I mean when I say it can be investigated historically? I mean it can be investigated without assuming or relying on the inspiration of the Bible. Normally, see, I'm convinced the Bible is the Word of God. You show me something in the Bible, okay, that's good for me. But you know, you go to tell somebody else and you say, look, I want you, the Bible's the Word of God. And they say, I don't believe that. Okay, What I'm telling you is, in a historical investigation, we can treat the biblical documents as we would any other ancient secular document. You don't get to just throw the Bible in the trash. They are ancient documents. Okay, so we're going to ignore the fact they're inspired and treat them purely as secular historical documents. Now, so we can investigate historically the resurrection of Christ. This doesn't mean that the resurrection can be proven through historical inquiry with absolute certainty. That is not how historical inquiry works. It's detective work. Historical inquiry is detective work in which one infers the most likely explanation of various bits of data. So I have all this data sprinkled around, and then I'm inferring what is the most likely explanation of this data that I have in the past. And so that's how historical investigation works. Absolute certainty, metaphysical certainty, is beyond the grasp of the methodology. But that's not a strike against it. We don't wind up saying, well, then you can't know anything historically. No, we say we can be reasonably confident of many things historically. Listen to what Gary Habermas and Michael Lacona, how they explain this. They said, virtually nothing can be established with 100% certainty. Can we know with 100% certainty that George Washington was the first president of the United States of America rather than a mythical figure? Everybody say, oh yeah, sure. You put a gun to my head, I'd say, yeah. But can you know metaphysically certain? You see, they go and say, perhaps documents were forged and stories invented in a conspiracy to encourage the citizens of a new country. We can know that this was not the case with a high degree of certainty, but not with metaphysical certainty, because that is beyond the grasp of the historical methodology. Now, the evidence for Jesus' resurrection is so strong that Boston College philosophers Peter Kreeft and Ronald Tosselli, they assert Christ's resurrection can be proved with at least as much certainty as any universally believed and well-documented event in ancient history. I can only here summarize the high. I think I took, when I taught the resurrection of Christ, I think I took 6 weeks doing it. I can't do that. You see, I can't just as a piece of this larger thing I'm doing, I can only raise these things and point you in directions. I can't fully explore some of these things. But if you'll go to this website, which is my website, and by the way, if you go there and see it and like it, do tell other people about it. I just like to spread this stuff around. All right, you go there, and if you click on the Bible Studies tab, you'll find this article, The Historical Case for the Resurrection of Christ. You can look at that, and you can assess then how well I support the various points of the argument. So you can look there for more details. What I can do here is just give it to you in a nutshell. Okay, so I'm just going to kind of give you the points of it. I think that's 31 pages, something like that, 32 pages. But I'll just give you the points of it. And the first point is that the disciples sincerely believed, and you can demonstrate this clearly, but that the disciples sincerely believed that Jesus had been resurrected, that he had been raised from the dead. They were certain of that fact. They were certain of that fact. Now, I'm aware, I got something coming around on me. I'm aware that sincerely believing something is true, that doesn't mean it is true. I know that, okay? But it's still very significant. If you follow me, you'll see why it is significant. Now, we know the disciples sincerely believed this, that the disciples were certain that Jesus had been raised from the dead. We know this because we have multiple early and independent sources that make clear the disciples believed Jesus had been resurrected. If you'll go to the paper I mentioned, I give you the multiple early and independent sources that demonstrate this is in fact what the disciples believe. So we have that, multiple early and independent sources, but we also have numerous facts and circumstances that corroborate what those sources tell us about the disciples' belief. It's like having testimony of multiple moviegoers that they believed there was a fire in the theater. Okay, so I have a lot of people all there. They're telling me, yes, yes, this is what we thought, this is what we... So I have multiple moviegoers telling me they thought there was a fire in the theater, and having the corroborating evidence that they broke through the doors and fled in panic. So I not only do I have early multiple independent sources, I have facts and circumstances that corroborate what the early multiple independent sources say about the disciples' belief. So I can get to a high degree of certainty that the disciples did in fact believe that Jesus had been raised from the dead. That's what they thought. Now, that evidence is so powerful that virtually all scholars across the spectrum, liberal to conservative, crazy to evangelical, that they accept that as a historical fact. They accept that the earliest Christians at least believed they had encountered the risen Jesus. In his 2005 article titled "Resurrection Research from 1975 to the Present, What Are Critical Non-Evangelical Scholars Saying?" Gary Habermas, he writes, "As we have mentioned throughout, there are certainly disagreements about the nature of the experiences of the disciples, but it is still crucial that the nearly unanimous consent of critical scholars, not evangelicals, critical scholars, is that in some sense, the early followers of Jesus thought that they had seen the risen Jesus." And in support of that assertion, Habermas cites his 2003 book, The Risen Jesus and Future Hope, where he provides a list of over 50 recent critical scholars who affirm these resurrection experiences as historical events. In 2000, the historian Paula Fredrickson, she's a historian at Boston University, she says, "I know in their own terms what they saw was the raised Jesus." That's what they say, and then all the historic evidence we have afterward attests to their conviction that that's what they saw. I'm not saying that they really did see the raised Jesus. I wasn't there. I don't know what they saw, but I do know that as a historian, that they must have seen something. I'm with that. They must have seen something. Now, the deep conviction. So first we have this conviction that everybody seems to recognize that the disciples did in fact have a genuine, sincere conviction that they had encountered Jesus raised from the dead. And the deep conviction of early Christians that Jesus was raised from the dead, that could have come about only if they were convinced of two things. They had to be convinced both that Jesus' tomb was empty and that they had encountered Jesus as a resurrected person and not simply as a ghost or hallucination. Either one of those alone would have been insufficient to produce the conviction that everyone agrees that they had. Would have been insufficient to produce the conviction that Jesus had been raised from the dead. If they believed that they had encountered the risen Jesus, but his body was still in the tomb, well, then they would have recognized, they would have been as quick as anybody to explain the appearances as some kind of ghostly visitation or hallucination. On the other hand, if the tomb was empty, but the disciples had not encountered the risen Jesus, they would have assumed the body had been taken. Whether it had been taken by grave robbers, whether it had been taken by enemies, in neither case, if either one of those things was missing, in neither case would they conclude that Jesus had been raised from the dead. They had to be convinced that the tomb was empty and they had encountered him bodily after his death. Resurrection appearance is not merely a hallucination or a ghostly visitation and an empty tomb. Got to have both of them. Let me illustrate that in a modern context. See, when you have the grieving widow in a mystery story, she thinks she glimpsed her dead husband walking down the sidewalk. Okay, so whoa, you know, we got an Alfred Hitchcock thing going on in there. We look and sees her husband, catches a glimpse of him. Well, they go and they dig up the body. They dig up the coffin, and if the corpse is still in there, well, then there's another explanation for the evidence that her husband was alive, right? I mean, something else is going on. You didn't see him right. You know, somebody's playing a trick on you, whatever it is. There he sits. He's dead. Okay, case closed. So if you have somebody who thinks they have evidence that he's still alive, you go to the tomb, you go to the grave, dig up the coffin, they're still there, case closed. There's some other explanation for that. And then on the other hand, if you learn by accident that a coffin is empty, like maybe they're exhuming a body and they go to the wrong place and they pull up the coffin, open it up, the casket, and it's empty. Well, nobody concludes from that fact alone that the dead guy was back raised from the dead. No, you would say, well, okay, this means that an unscrupulous funeral home director, he did something, sold the body on the black market, or somebody stole the body, or something like that. You don't jump from just an empty coffin to saying, well, somebody's raised from the dead. You have to have both. You see, you have to have both. So we know that they had the conviction that Jesus was raised from the dead, and we can see that that conviction requires a conviction of an empty tomb and a resurrection appearance. Okay, so we know they had those things. You say, well, okay, are we just stuck then? Do we just have to say that from the fact they believed Jesus was raised from the dead, do we just have to infer that then they had these two other convictions that are necessary for that belief? Or is there any evidence of how they would have come to believe the tomb was empty, and how they would have come to believe that they had encountered the risen Jesus? We have plenty of evidence. We have plenty of evidence, you see, and all of the available evidence indicates all of it. Do we have historical evidence? Do we have document? Not talking about being inspired. I'm just talking about, do we have any historical documentation that will guide us in how did they come to the conviction, which we know they must have had, that the tomb was empty and that they had encountered the risen Jesus? All of the evidence that we have suggests and says that they came to the conviction the tomb was empty because they saw with their own eyes the tomb was empty. All of the evidence that we have says they came to the conviction they had encountered the risen Jesus because he gave every indication of being present in body. So it's not like we don't have evidence. So now we have evidence that shows the subsidiary things that go into the conviction. We have a clear-cut case that they sincerely believe this, and there is no other theory of Jesus, no theory other than Jesus' resurrection that can plausibly explain. No other theory than Jesus' resurrection that can plausibly explain how from the earliest days the disciples were convinced that Jesus' tomb was empty and that they had encountered him in bodily form after his death. Many alternative theories have been proposed. If you've played around in this world, you know that. Many alternative theories have been run up the flagpole. But for anybody whose mind is the least bit open to the possibility of God's existence and thus to the possibility of Christ's resurrection, those attempts must be judged abject failures. Absolutely abject failures. They simply do not explain the data that must be explained. They do not explain the facts that must be explained. Michael Lacona, he writes in the conclusion of his massive study, over 700 pages, The Resurrection of Jesus, A New Historiographical Approach. He says, I strictly adhered to a controlled historical method throughout this investigation, surveying and assessing the relevant sources for a collection of strongly evidenced facts that are agreed on by virtually all scholars studying the subject. So he first sets out and he says, what can I get near unanimous consent on as the data that need to be explained? And then he says, and then weighing a number of hypotheses representative of what's being proposed at the beginning of the 21st century, well, what are the things out there floating in the academic world where we're saying, okay, these are the data that have to be explained, and we're going to try this to do it, and we're going to try this to do it, and he weighs all of those. And then he winds up saying, in the end, the resurrection hypothesis came out on top. and meets the standards discussed herein for being historical. The renowned scholar and theologian, N.T. Wright, he wrote an 800-plus page book on the resurrection of the Son of God. And he said in his 2008 book called Surprised by Hope, he says, all this brings us face to face with the ultimate question. The empty tomb and the meetings with Jesus are as well established by the arguments I have advanced as any historical data could expect to be. They are, in combination, the only possible explanation for the stories and beliefs that grew up so quickly among Jesus' followers. How, in turn, do we explain them? How do we explain the empty tomb and the resurrection meetings with Jesus? He says, in any other historical inquiry, the answer would be so obvious that it would hardly need saying. Here, of course, this obvious answer, well, it actually happened. He says, is so shocking, so earth-shattering, that we rightly pause before leaping into the unknown. And here indeed, as some skeptical friends have cheerfully pointed out to me, it is always possible for anyone to follow the argument so far and to say simply, I don't have a good explanation for what happened to cause the empty tomb and the appearances. But I choose to maintain my belief that dead people don't rise, and therefore conclude that something else must have happened, even though we can't tell what it was. That's fine. I respect that position. But I simply note that it is indeed then a matter of choice, not a matter of saying that something called scientific historiography forces us to take that route. But at this moment in the argument, all the signposts are pointing in one direction. I and others have studied quite extensively all the alternative explanations, ancient and modern, for the rise of the early church and the shape of its belief. Far and away, the best historical explanation is that Jesus of Nazareth, having been thoroughly dead and buried, really was raised to life on the third day with a renewed body, not a mere resuscitated corpse, as people sometimes dismissively say, a new kind of physical body which left an empty tomb behind it because it had used up the material of Jesus' original body, which possessed new properties that nobody expected or imagined, but that generated significant mutations in the thinking of those who encountered it. They transformed some elements of Jewish theology. He says, if something like this happened, it would perfectly explain why Christianity began and why it took the shape it did. So you see, this historical inquiry, you're looking at all these points, these facts that have to be explained. And you look and you say, well, the hypothesis of a resurrection, by the way, from somebody who claimed he was going to be resurrected and who performed miracles. But that answers all of these things. How did they so quickly come to this conviction of an empty tomb and this conviction of these resurrection appearances? The things that are tried, and you can read the paper, I give those fairly short shrift too, because I spend most of the time in the paper going through the evidence to nail down these, how you can know these certain things for facts. But that answers the question, like he says, far and away better. What is the resistance? The resistance is, you come to the conclusion that Jesus was raised from the dead, and your world's changing. Now, I can tell you that as a fact. Coming from an atheistic background, as somebody who started to dig, Brother John started jumping on me and got me to read the Bible. I told him I'd read the New Testament, read that, and then I started reading other things, read some apologetics books. And I remember telling the guys in my office, these legal types, telling them, I said, hey, if you know what a summary judgment is in law, I said, this is summary judgment material. Summary judgment is where the judge sits here and he says that there's no real dispute about this, that the case is, there's nothing to be tried. This is a slam dunk. Let me put it in the vernacular. So that's like, you know, so that's what I was saying. And so once that happens, when you come to that conviction, that's watershed, baby. Because now I have this miracle worker who claimed to be the Son of God who's raised from the dead. It's not an Easter only deal. This is resurrection life, and he's raised from the dead. So that's why the resistance, people fight that, because if I swallow that, then I'll tell you, I heard that first bell. There was a guy I was working with. I tried to get people to read the Bible. I said, look, just read the Gospel of John. Just read the Gospel of John. I don't have time for that. I don't have time. Okay. This one guy was reading Shogun back in the day. This is in the 70s. This looks like this fat. So I hold up the Gospel of John. I'm holding it like this. I said, it's just this many pages. Just read it. And he came to me one day and he said, look, there's a reason. He said, because reading that is not like reading these other things, because that calls you to a decision. I said, all right, that's honest. That's honest. I go for that. But I want you to see. This is everybody know I'm Dr. Spock. I'm just here weighing that. Look, there's resistance to these things because people say, I know, and if I swallow that, and if I'm going to live consistently with my conviction, then a whole lot's going to change in my life. And am I prepared to follow the risen Jesus? You say, a lot of stuff goes on with that. Okay, let me mention the next thing. All that I've been talking about. Well, before I get to that, we've been talking about, you know, this idea, this big thing with the new atheists is, look, if you're a Christian or religion in general, Christianity in particular, you're brain dead. Okay, you believe things that are delusions, that are fantasies, that you have absolutely no reason, no rational basis to believe are true. You are, in Harris's words, you are like somebody who believes Nicole Kidman is in love with him even though they've never met. You're just out of your mind. Okay? So what I've been doing, I've been trying over the how many weeks, walk through this and say, au contraire, there are plenty of rational, reasonable grounds to think God exists and that the claims of Christianity are true. Okay, now when you go through something like that, you have people sometimes regarding the evidence of God's existence. People like Richard Dawkins, they will say, look, if God existed and wanted to convince us of it, he could fill the world with super miracles. You see, he could just fill the world with super miracles and everybody would know he exists. But as the Oxford philosopher and theologian Richard Swinburne has explained, there is quite a lot of evidence for God's existence. And too much might not be good for us. Now, that last clause there that I've italicized, that sent Dawkins into a tizzy when he said that. See, because Dawkins said, look, he said that it was absurd and that it revealed a hostile attitude toward evidence itself. But Swinburne's point was that God may well have a reason for setting the evidence at the exact level that will allow those who want to believe in him to do so, but will allow those who do not want to believe in him not to do so. He may well have a reason for putting it right there. In other words, it's possible God doesn't want to force someone to come to him. You see, who really doesn't want to come to him, he doesn't want to make them an offer they can't refuse, so to speak. He doesn't want to do that by removing any intellectual space for the exercise of their desire to reject him. In other words, he doesn't want to overwhelm the intellect so that there's no space for those who want to deny him to do it intellectually. Okay? Could God have that reason? Sure. He's setting the thing, he could be doing that. As the expression goes, a person convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. God wants, I heard that bell, God wants to move the will, the desire to believe, and it's certainly possible that he has set the evidentiary environment as he wants it for that purpose. He is wooing us rather than forcing himself on us. You say, why is he doing that? Well, he is God, and I will ask him. But that's what, see, I can see a rationale that he's doing that. He sets that, he's leaving space for people like Dawkins who want to continue to, but as Swinburne said, there's plenty of evidence for him. Okay, that is not enough. I want him to come down here and juggle or do something for me. Well, he's God. And you have to recognize that he can be doing that. I heard that second bell. Thank you. For,